Oh, he is so good this morning, isn't he?
Yes.
Yes. Let's stand. We're going to get ready to worship our Lord and Savior this morning. And as we stand, I want us to be remindful and reflect why we worship. And this is what I say. Worship is my response to what I value most. And what I value most is God. I was made by Him and for Him. He is awesome beyond comprehension. I exist for the sole purpose of reflecting back to God His matchless glory. I will exalt Him with my mouth and with my life, for He is my hope, He is my joy, my strength, and He is above all my salvation. Amen this morning. Amen. Let's worship this morning.
Through Father, it is well with our souls this morning. Father, I'm reminded this morning of that storm. It was raging all around, and people were just freaking out on that boat. They were in unfamiliar territory, God, as the winds began to beat upon their sails and water began to lap into their boat. Father, you spoke peace and you spoke calm, even in the midst of what appeared to be chaos. Father, I thank you this morning for your peace, and I thank you this morning that we can say it is well with our soul. Father, that in the midst of chaos, in the midst of pain, in the midst of troubled times, Lord, we can say it is well. Thank you for that this morning. I thank you, Father, for your love and your grace, your strength and your wisdom. I thank you, Father, for the blessings that you bestowed in our lives, for you are one amazing God, and we never fail to give you praise. Have the deacons and deaconess come on down. We're gonna go ahead and take our offering up to this next song. You know, God asks us to offer our lives to Him, to make Him Lord, amen. And not only does He ask us to give our lives, but to give our everything. And part of our giving everything is giving our tithes and offerings back to the Lord. And saying, God, you've blessed me. This is how I want to bless you. You know, it's not about blessing the church. It's not about blessing the pastor. It's about blessing the kingdom of God. Amen. And so as we go into this last song here, we're going to take an offering up and believe God for great things. Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's continue worshiping this morning.
God, amen. Isn't it nice to see those kids up here? We've been praying for young people and kids, and God is beginning to answer our prayer, amen. And God is doing a good job as long as we stay out of the way and let him do what he's doing, right? And he's doing it, and it's exciting to see what he's doing as he's bringing in some young people. We're going to go into communion this morning, and I want to read out chapter 5 of Romans and some really good verses talking about the blood of Christ and the importance of the blood. In verse 1 it says, "Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ." Now, I love that verse right off bat because it doesn't say justified by our works. Do you hear what I'm saying? It said justified by our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? And that's important to note. "Through whom also we have obtained our introduction by faith into this grace in which we stand, and we exalt in hope of the glory of God. And not only this, but we also exalt in our tribulations." Oh boy. Anybody going through some mess right now? And he's saying, we're supposed to exalt through this. We're supposed to have joy in this. Oh boy. There's some tribulations that calls for a lot of grace, right? It says, "Knowing that tribulation brings about perseverance." Okay, well, that's a good thing. Anybody need some perseverance in here? That means to keep on keeping on, as the air we used to say. Just keep on keeping on. "And perseverance, proven character." Wow. You know, I've always been told from the time I was a kid, my grandpa used to tell me this. He said, "Boy, I tell you what you're made of. Let me put you through some troubles, because your true self will come out during those troubled times." And that's important to note, amen? And he's saying perseverance, troubles, you know, we find hope and glory of God in this, but to persevere through that. Why? Because it's going to develop character in us. But listen to what it says. "Improving character produces hope and not disappointment." Wow. That's amazing. How many needs hope this morning? I mean, you look around the world, you see everything that's going on and what God, you know, is trying to do among his people and stuff, and then you see those that are just pushing one way or the other. You know, one thing that I can say about this world, and the thing especially in the culture of the United States right now, it seems like the divide between the good and bad is getting wider. It's getting more and more obvious who's righteous and who is unrighteous, who's holy and who's unholy, who's for God and who's not for God. That divide is getting wider. It says, "Been poured out, the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who he has given us. For while we were still helpless," I love this, "while we were still helpless, at that right time, Christ died for the ungodly." Think about that. When you were a sinner and you were a mess, When we get into our little squabbles and messes and everything else, and this thing, world just seems to be falling apart around us, God still died for us even though we were lost. Even though we were far from him, he died for us. What a beautiful word. "For one would hardly die for a righteous man, though perhaps for the good man someone would dare to even die. But God..." And this is what I want to end on right here. "But God demonstrates his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through him." You know, Paul writes in Corinthians, he says, "To do this in remembrance of me until the Lord come." But we forget that first part sometimes. It says to proclaim his death. What's so important about his death? The fact is that through the cross, that his death upon the cross brought justification so that you can be saved, not through works of yourself, but by faith through the saved blood of Jesus Christ. And if there's anybody here this morning, and we're going to give opportunity later on, if you're saying, "I don't know what that looks like, what it means to be saved through the blood of Jesus Christ," we're going to give opportunity later on for you to be able to respond to that. But the reason why we take a communion is because we're reminded that because of the precious blood, because of what Christ did on Calvary, we can give thanks back to him. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Oh, the love of Jesus.
There's nothing too dirty that you can make worthy. You wash me in mercy. I am clean. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy. Chest. Oh, I'm coming alive with joy and destiny. 'Cause you're restoring me piece by piece. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. Wash me in mercy. I am clean. There's nothing too dirty that you can't make worthy. You wash me in mercy.
Are you clean today? That's a good question, isn't it? If you're not clean, the Bible says today is the day of salvation, and you can become clean before the Lord, and God can do amazing things. Amen. She won't kill me later for this, but I'm glad to have my daughter Belle in service with us this morning. Amen. Amen. So she's not going to sing or anything. I'm not public dad. I'm like, all right, okay. she got back from Costa Rica last night, was down there for almost 2 weeks, wasn't it? And just working with the children and stuff. And so it's I'm proud of you. That's for sure. You got a proud dad up here, Belle. God is good. That is for sure. I want to go to Acts chapter 1 this morning. And we... been talking about the last words of Jesus, and there's some things that when his last words, sometimes we forget about some things that we were always reminded about. But this morning, I want to kind of focus on some last words of Jesus that he talked about. And even two angels after he went to heaven and he ascended into heaven, two angels appeared and told the disciples about. In Acts chapter 1, says this, "The first account I composed, Theophilus, and about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after he had by the Holy Spirit given orders to the apostles whom he had chosen. To these he also presented himself alive after suffering by many convincing proofs." And we talked about that last week, how God has already given us the evidence. But do we believe the evidence? You know, we can see the evidence standing right in front of us, but if we don't believe it, it doesn't matter. And so here Jesus, all these convincing proofs, appearing to them over a period of 40 days and speaking of the things concerning the kingdom of God, which just kind of gives, you know, we have this idea that, you know, Easter happened, he comes out of the grave and he goes to heaven. And sometimes if we watch movies and stuff like that, we get this idea that it was like immediate, like he just rose from the grave and went to heaven. But that's not what happened at all. He actually walked the earth for 40 days after his resurrection. And Acts tells us this right here. "Gathering them together, he commanded them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait for what the Father had promised, which he said, you heard of from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they were asking him, saying, "Lord, is it at this time you are restoring the kingdom of Israel?" Didn't that sound familiar? They're just missing it again. Here Jesus is trying to speak something spiritual to them, and they completely miss it because they're caught up in the natural. "He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or the epochs which the Father has fixed by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and even to the remotest parts of the earth." And after he had said these things, he was lifted up while they were looking on, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And as they were gazing intently into the sky while he was going, behold, two men in white clothing stood beside them. They also said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand here looking in the sky? This Jesus who has been taken up from you into heaven will come in just the same way as you have watched him go into heaven." Father, I ask this morning that you would just remove every single distraction that is around us. Father, help us this morning to focus upon receiving your word, receiving from you. God, that we would focus this morning our attention upon the word that you want us to respond to. Father, I thank you this morning that your word tells us that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God for the pulling down of strongholds. And Lord, your word also tells us in Isaiah that every tongue that rises up against us, that we would condemn by the power of Jesus' name. And so, Father, we thank you today for your faithfulness. We thank you for your love. And Holy Spirit, we invite you into this place today because, Lord, there's nothing I can say, nothing I can do that would change a life. But, Lord, with you, everything is possible. So, Father, we give you thanks and we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Well, praise the Lord. To kind of give you a little bit of background as to what's going on here, when you go into Acts chapter 1, this is right after Jesus had already appeared in the upper room with the disciples. And if you remember, after the crucifixion, Mary and all of them run to the tomb and they find that Jesus is not there anymore. And the angels tells Mary and them, you need to go back and tell the disciples your story. And we kind of talked about that last week, that we all have a story, our experience with God. What is our story? What is our witness? What is it that we need to tell the world? What is it that God has done in our life? And we kind of talked about that last week. And so they're running back, and the messengers tells them to go tell the disciples. But when Mary gets there, and Peter had already seen the resurrection and this kind of thing, and so when they get there, Mary finds that they're in this locked room, scared to death. Now, doesn't that just sound like the disciples? They don't show up at the cross of Christ. Here you have the Savior that has done all these miracles, and because the things didn't go the way they thought, they ran from the cross. They ran from the suffering. They ran from the thing that Jesus was trying to do in their life. They ran. And here they are. They're scared, and they're locked in this upper room. And we know that from last week that Jesus just appears right before them. Just shows up and appears right in their midst. And as he appears in their midst, he begins to show their hands, his hands and his feet. And even though he had the evidence, there were some that still did not believe the evidence. And we talked about that last week, and it leads us into this piece right here, because now we're past that, and Jesus has met them on the Sea of Galilee. You know, they're out fishing, and Jesus is standing on the edge of the sea, and he's hollering out to them, "Hey, have you caught anything?" And we're aware of the fact that in John, the last chapter of John, Jesus begins to restore Peter by asking him if he loved him or not. And so all this has passed, and now it's 10 days before Pentecost. 10 days before Jesus pours out the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And here we have right here, Jesus giving some last instructions, giving them some things that he wants them to do while they're waiting. See, Acts is a continuation of the book of Luke. And I would encourage you to do this, it would be awesome, is actually read through the book of Luke and then read through the book of Acts. Because Luke wrote the book of Luke, obviously, but he also wrote the book of Acts. And in Acts chapter or verse 1, it talks about this, because Paul says this is a continuation of what Jesus began to do and teaches, the continuation of what I want to say about Jesus. And so you find that the combination of the Luke and Acts is a real comprehension, a good comprehension of the combination of Christ and the church in the New Testament. But Acts goes from resurrection to the ascension of Jesus Christ, the fulfillment of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, to the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on all the church age for the kingdom of God, so that we can build the kingdom of God. Jesus provided all this evidence over a period of 40 days. I mean, could you imagine? You know, and I mentioned this last week, that Jesus did so much in 40 days. In just 40 days. That not all the books in the world can contain all the miracles and things that he'd done. Just in 40 days. And then we think that God can't move on our behalf. Man. That's a good thing to know, is that Jesus has all these great miracles just in 40 days. But he can move in the impossible, amen? Jesus also spoke about the kingdom of God and some coming events. Jesus left the crowd with a command, and we find this in the first chapter of Acts. He left them with a command, and he said, "Don't leave this area, don't leave Jerusalem until you receive the promise of the Father, the baptism of the Holy Spirit." See, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and next week is Pentecost Sunday, and we'll get more into that then, but the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not about being Pentecostal. It's not about being charismatic. It's about receiving the promise of the Father that is right in the Scriptures. That's what it's about. It's not about a fellowship or denomination. It's about receiving all that God has for you. That's what it's about. And Jesus said the Father has this empowerment called the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's a promise from the Father to those that believe. So Jesus leaves the crowd and he gives them the command, don't stay there or stay there until you receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And we know that this is not the same as receiving the Holy Spirit like we do at the moment of salvation, because when you go in the latter chapter of John, the disciples had already received the Holy Spirit when Jesus breathed on them. And we talked about that last week, how he opened their mind to understand or to comprehend the Scriptures. See, Jesus, though he was talking spiritual, the disciples missed it once again. Because what ends up happening is Jesus is trying to tell them that God has got a promise for you, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to work in your behalf with gifts and all kinds of different things that's going to empower you to be the witness. And what in the world does the disciples do? They miss the spiritual lesson and they immediately focus their eyes on the natural things. Immediately. And you find that right here in the first chapter. How do you know that? Because what do? They don't ask anything about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I mean, how many of you, if Jesus showed up on a scene and he said, hey, I got the baptism of the Holy Spirit for you, and you've never heard of it before, would have questions about what that is? Many of us would. But they didn't ask questions about what the baptism of the Holy Spirit was. They asked a natural question. When are you going to restore Israel? They didn't ask the question, what is the kingdom of God going to be like now that Gentiles can be saved? They didn't ask, what's it going to be like when you come back from heaven? Because we know you're about to go there. What does that look like? They didn't even ask that. They focused on the natural instead of the spiritual. And they missed it again. And this is exactly what happened. This, we find this happens with the disciples over and over and over again. And how many know it's easy for us to do the same thing? We get so focused on the natural things that we completely miss what God is trying to do among us. Or we hinder what God is trying to do among us because we're so focused on the natural. See, we can hinder the work of God, and we don't want to do that. And I thank God that when Jesus talked to them and he told them, even though they were in their humanity and they could have missed it, Jesus' grace still moved so that they did not miss it. Amen? And that is encouraging. We can often be so focused upon the natural, we either overlook or ignore what God is trying to do in the spiritual. This promise was fulfilled in Acts, talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit in chapter 2. And it's for all generations. It's not just for the disciples. It's for all generations. And we no longer must wait for the promise, but just simply wait for the Father to do what he wants to do among us. But I don't want to talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit this morning. That's not what I want to talk about. I want to talk about the second thing that Jesus talked about that I believe is so important. Jesus spoke about his soon coming and his return. He talked about that, and we find that Jesus not only says this, but he also, we have two angels that confirmed it to the disciples when they are looking up into the clouds as Jesus is ascending into heaven, and they're looking up in the clouds, and these two strange guys come up, and I believe they were angels. They were clothed in white, and they come up and they tell him, why are you staring up into the skies? Do you not know that this same Jesus that has left this earth and now has gone to heaven is going to come back in the same manner? That he's going to rip those clouds open and he's going to come back for you. Now, I could imagine that day and that morning, I'm sure those disciples were thinking, oh yeah, we're going to see Jesus tomorrow. You know, they're probably getting all excited, and they're probably, you know, all this other stuff, and they're getting excited about it and everything. But how many knows that 2019 years is a long time to wait? But when we read through the book of Hebrews in chapter 11, we also know that there was a lot of men and women in chapter 11 that died in the natural before they saw the promise of God in the spiritual. Whole entire chapter about the promise of God. The promise yet to be fulfilled. See, this is the only promise that's yet to be fulfilled. It's his return. So what does Jesus have to say about this? Well, let's go to Matthew 24 real quick. And Matthew 24 talks about this, and Jesus does a really good job. Of course he did, right? He's Jesus, right? And he explains through here what this looks like. Because, you know, I've heard people make this comment, well, you know, things have always been bad. They're just more publicly known. Well, you know what? They are more publicly known, but if you look at records, they are more bad. I know, I just tore my English up, didn't I? But they are. They're more frequent. I mean, think about this for a second. Even though we may have had high temperatures, we may have had greater floodings and this kind of thing, although some of this may not have even beat records yet, when you look through history, we know that it is more frequent. Earthquakes more frequent. Volcanoes more frequent. Tsunamis more frequent. Tornadoes more frequent. You know, I read a thing from the Missouri Storm Chasers, and they said that in between May 15th and May 30th,
United States had over 726 tornadoes. They're becoming more frequent. You know, we think about it and we're thinking, well, that's always been around. Yeah, it's always been around, but it's not been this frequent. It's not been, I mean, when was the last time that you remember that 36 is shut down, or you're going out YY Highway, going out toward the furniture store and all that shut down, or you're trying to get into Chillicothe and really the only way to get in there, and I probably said that city wrong again, but the only way to get in there is almost to get in there by boat. It's been a long time. The flooding is bad. It's bad. And so these things are happening and they're going on. And I've heard people say, oh, this has always been around. But it hasn't been this frequent. It hasn't been this frequent. Like the prophets and the people of the Old Testament that had to wait for Jesus to come, that had to wait in their anticipation of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, no different than them. We as believers now are anticipating our homecoming. Now we are anticipating the last promise that Jesus gave to the church, saying, I am going to come back for you. And there's some things that Jesus says about this that I think is really important in Matthew 24. Because Jesus explains about his return, but he also explains about our responsibility. You know, the Bible talks about in the last days that the love of many will wax cold. It talks about if the very even the very elect could possibly be deceived, they would in these last days. Where's your heart at this morning? Is your heart so on fire for God that you're willing to do anything it takes to win this world? Or are you just like caught up in your own little world, in your own little circle? Are you too busy for God? Are you too caught up in your own ideas and opinions that you miss what God is trying to do? Things that we have to think about. And Jesus brings this out in Matthew 24, 3 through 14. And we're going to read pieces of this, not the entire chapter, but pieces of this chapter, because I believe it's really important. Jesus explains it so well. And tell me when you read through this, if it doesn't sound like our day. Jesus says, as he was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately saying, tell us, when will these things happen? And what will be the sign of your coming of the end of the age? And Jesus answered and said to them, see to it that no one misleads you. And in some translation it says deceives you. For many will come in my name saying, I am the Christ, and I will mislead many. Anybody remember the David Koresh thing down in Texas? Claiming to be a Christ or whatever. And there's always these people rise up claiming to be the Messiah. You'll be hearing of wars and rumors of wars. Yeah, we've been hearing that. See that you're not frightened. Wow. For those things must take place, but that it is not yet the end. He's saying these things are going to take place. These things are going to happen. You think it's bad? Don't be frightened about it, though, because these things must happen. They're going to happen. But don't be frightened about it. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. And in various places there will be famines and earthquakes. But all these things are merely the beginning of birth pains. I don't know about you, but I say we're some major, I think we're about ready to deliver. You see the things going on around the world and, oh my goodness, you're like, wow, I think we're about ready to be delivered here. Verse 9, then they will deliver you to tribulation and will kill you, and you will be hated by all nations because of my name. At that time, many will fall away and will betray one another and hate one another. Anybody know that going on? I think the saddest thing today is when church people hate one another and fight and fought with one another, instead of bringing love together. What a bad witness to this world. Amen. The Bible, Jesus made it real plain. He said, how is the world going to know that I'm right, that I'm true? By our love for one another. Our love for one another. What does that mean? That means we got some, my brother and sister, if they're talking about you, you need to go over and you say, you need to stop that. Why? Because love protects. Love protects. And we need to protect one another, right? We're a family and we protect one another, and that's what we do. But notice right here, it says they will hate one another. They'll betray one another. How many of you got family members like that? You know, I've got family members like that. You know, I mean, it's unfortunate, but it's like they've turned their back on the whole entire family. And you're like, what in the world's going on? You're like, why? That will betray and hate one another. Notice verse 11. Many false prophets will arise and will mislead many. Because lawlessness is increased, most people's love will grow cold. Has your love for Jesus grown cold? Are you more concerned about your own agenda than you are about kingdom things? You say, well, yeah, it is. Let me put you to the test. Let's see if you've passed the test or not. Because I guarantee that there's going to be tests in life that our warmness or our coldness for God is going to be tested. And it's in the midst of our trials and in the midst of testing that we prove whether we're hot or cold. And we need to ask ourselves, where are we at? Are we hot this morning? Are we cold this morning? Are we caught up in our own agenda to the point that we're missing God and growing cold in our faith? Bottom line, it's not about us, amen? You know, I told somebody one time, I think it was when I was first started pastoring here, we were talking about just different things, and they said, well, how are you doing in that church? And they said, have you gotten your way? I said, no. I said, it's not about me. They kind of looked at me funny. I said, well, if I had my way about it, we'd have black choir up in here. We'd have big old black music going with that choir. You know how that music goes and everything else. We'd be dancing and shouting all in the halls and all in the aisleways. I said, the gifts of spirit would be moving like so crazy among us. We'd be thinking that we are living in the book of Acts all over again. I said, if I had my way, I would be like going to Pastor Tom's church, and anybody's watched his videos know what that's like. I mean, my own pastor gets so drunk in the spirit. I mean, it's crazy. Because he's so caught up in just wanting to follow the Lord. And granted, I mean, there's different expressions of worship and there's different expressions of having church. And that's all good and that's all fine and that's great. But we can never allow it to be about us and our agenda. We got to make it about the kingdom and reaching this world. Amen. But the love of many will grow cold. It will grow cold. But listen to verse 13. But the one who endures to the end, the one who endures to the end, he will be saved. The one who endures to the end, the one that doesn't run and hide and tuck his head between his legs or go and hide a wall or whatever you want to call it because, you know, but endures. It says, and then the gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in the whole world as a testimony to all the nations. And that word actually means ethnic groups. It says, and then the end will come. You know, I love talking to Bill about the Gideons a lot because he keeps up with how many Bible translations we got out there. He keeps up with the ideas of like how many languages we have yet to conquer and, you know, all that kind of stuff. But do you know that we only have a little roughly over 2,000 more languages to conquer in this world before we've reached every ethnic group with the gospel? That is amazing. You're saying, well, that's a whole lot. Well, what you don't understand is they are interpreting hundreds a year. Because of different computer software and stuff that we have. What does that mean? It means our home departure is coming soon. And I don't know about you, but I'm ready to go. Amen? I'm ready to go. But Jesus says, he said, don't be deceived or misled and endure the testing, endure the pressure. Paul talks about it in the epistles, and he said, endure like a good soldier, but preach the gospel, reach the world. Matthew 24, 29 through 31, Jesus goes on after he talks about this, and I skipped a couple of verses here. In verse 29, says, but immediately after the tribulation of those days, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of the heavens will be shaken. And then the Son of Man will appear in the sky And then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. Could you just imagine this? And he will send forth his angels with a great trumpet, and will gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of the sky to another. What is Jesus saying here? He's saying, be prepared and recognize the sign of his coming. He's saying, don't be misled. Don't grow cold. Don't be about your own agenda, but be about the Father's business. Don't make it about you and yourself and your preferences and ideas and everything else. Make it about the kingdom. Yeah, I do these things, but you need to recognize that I'm coming and I'm coming soon. Amen. Be prepared. Be ready. And in verse 32, Jesus goes on. He says, now learn the parable from the fig tree. When its branch has already become tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So you too, when you see all these things, recognize that he is near. Is he telling us that we can set a date and time? No. Remember the book, Jesus, all the reasons Jesus is going to come back in 1988? Remember the book that went out, all the reasons why year 2000 turned around, how the world was just going to explode and fall apart? I tell you what, if you're a false prophet, God will eventually make a fool of you. Because he's not going to share his glory with anybody, and he's not going to be contradicted. And that's exactly what happened with these people, because you cannot call a date and time. You can recognize the seasons. You can recognize that things are wrapping up and shaping up and that we need to be ready and be prepared. But we cannot set a date. Why? Because Jesus said that only the Father knows that. Only the Father. Wow. Verse 33, so you too, when you see all these things, recognize that he is near, right at the door. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Amen. What a promise. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, nor the Son, but the Father alone. For the coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. For as in those days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark. And they did not understand until the flood came and took them all away. So will the Son of Man be. Then there will be two men in the field. One will be taken and one be left. Two women will be grinding at the mill. One will be taken and one left. Will there be car wrecks on that day? You better believe it. Will there be plane dropping out of the sky that day? You better believe it. Will there be Saul's all of a sudden just dropping into midair? You better believe it. That day that he comes back is going to be a glorious day. When that trumpet sounds, are you going to be ready for him? Are you going to be ready when he splits those clouds wide open? The signs of the times are here. We've got to recognize the signs. We've got to recognize his return is forever before us. Matthew 24, 42 through 51, and I'm tying this up right here. In 42 through 51, Jesus gives us some real clear instructions. He's saying you need to recognize the times. You need to not be misled, and you can't let your love grow cold. But right here, Jesus nails it home real good. He says, therefore, be on alert. Are you sleeping today? If you knew somebody was about to break in your house, I guarantee you would not go to bed. If you knew that something bad was about to happen to one of your children, you would not just... What would you do? You would be on alert. You would be ready. You'd be prepared for what is about to happen. Why? Because you want to protect that child. You want to protect your home. And so you are on the alert, meaning that you are on that edge. You are just ready. You're waiting. You're watching. You're expecting. And Jesus says right here, he says, be on the alert, for you do not know which day your Lord is coming. You don't know. It could be today, it could be tomorrow, you don't know. But be sure of this, that if the head of the house had known of what time of night the thief was coming, he would have been on the alert and would not have allowed his house to be broken into. I guarantee it, I probably would have been sitting at the door with a shotgun. Amen? Okay, nobody's going. Okay. Some of y'all would be like, all right. I know some of y'all. Y'all would be more than one shotgun. But you would be ready. You'd be sitting at that door. You would keep them from being broken in. For this reason, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour when you do not think he will. Who then is faithful and sensible? Who is then the faithful and sensible slave whom his master put in charge of his household to give them their food at the proper time? Blessed is that slave whom his master finds so doing when he comes. Truly I say to you that he will put him in charge of all his possessions. But if that evil slave says in his heart, my master is not coming for a long time. How many people we know like that? Oh, Jesus says he's coming back. Yeah. You know, if we believe Jesus would come back at any time, we'd live different. We'd think different. We'd do different. And we would realize the urgency of reaching the lost out of here, no matter what it would cost us. But because we don't really believe that he can come back at any minute, I don't believe that we really live the way that we should in that urgency and that alertness and being ready and prepared. Because if we did, we would literally do anything and everything we had to do to reach the lost. Because we don't want others to go to hell. We don't want our children to go to hell. We don't want our parents to go to hell. We don't want the youth and all those that are here in our city to go to hell. And if we truly believe that he was coming back at any minute, we would make any sacrifice that we would have to make to see that happen. The question is not whether Jesus is coming back and he can come back at any minute. The question is, are you living like you believe that? The question is if you truly believe that, are you willing to make the sacrifices necessary to live that out? See, that's where it gets tricky. That's where it gets real tricky. Because it's easy in our human nature to get real content and comfortable with the familiar. And so do we. What do we end up doing? We just sit there. Unchangeable, unmovable. I mean, think about it. We do. We're stubborn. That's what we do. I get stubborn. I'll admit it. Sin. Being stubborn is a sin. Matter of fact, the Bible says it's a form of witchcraft. But I get stubborn. Why? Because normally when I get stubborn, it's because I'm familiar with this and I don't want to change in what God's trying to do, and I get stubborn about it. And so God begins to bring the Holy Spirit, and he's convicting me. I'm in his word and I'm reading and I'm trying to apply and I'm trying to get creative ideas from God. I'm like, God, how do we reach this world? God, how do we do this? God, how do we do that? And we try and we pray for creative ideas, and that creative idea comes and we're like, oh, I don't like that. Why? Because we've not settled in our heart the urgency of winning a world. And winning the world for Christ is not about us. He's coming back, and there ain't no stopping it. There's no stopping it. You say, well, do you know when he's coming back? Well, I tell you what, if he comes back through the clouds, or you leave this house today and you end up in a hospital and you die of a heart attack, or you end up in a car accident, or you end up going out here and you're in a drive-by or whatever happens, that is your second coming. You know, I've told this story before. When I was in youth group, we had a 16-year-old boy that was in our youth group that was causing so much trouble and so much ruckus. The adults did not want him around their youth. And our youth pastor kept telling us over and over and over, we're praying for him, we're believing for him. We are aware of what's going on. We're protecting our youth, but I believe God is going to speak to this young man. He upset the church people. I ain't going to lie. He upset them. But he believed God regardless if he upset the people. You know what happened to that 16-year-old boy? He got saved. You know what happened that night? He's walking home. And as he's walking home, gets hit by a car and dies right there on the street. What if that youth pastor wasn't willing to take that step of faith? What if that youth pastor said, well, I'm going to be a people pleaser instead of a God pleaser? What if that youth pastor said, I'm going to make it about this or make it about that, instead of seeing and understanding the urgency of Christ can come at any moment? See, that young man's coming to Christ was that day at 16 years old when he crossed that street. Jesus does not have to come back splitting through the clouds for you to go and meet him. But I'm telling you right now, we need to live right here, right now, with the urgency and understanding that it's not about us, it's about him, and it's about his kingdom. And we need to be so wrapped up in what he is trying to do in our lives and reaching the lost and reaching our world that we live like we believe it. Amen. The question this morning is do you live like you believe it? Is the urgency truly there? Because if it is, we would be like William Carey saying, I would give up everything and anything in my life and live at the gates of hell if I had to save a sinner. You know, I sit and sometimes I think about the family, you know, I haven't been home, you know, this is what God's calling does. I have not been home to Kentucky and lived with my family for almost my entire adult life because God's called me out to different areas. And sometimes I get in my little pity party because I make it about me and I begin to miss my family and I want to go home and all this other stuff. And you know what God reminds me of? You've not given up anything. Did you see the picture of the guy that got his head cut off for the gospel? Did you see the church that got blown up for the gospel? And you think because you're 600 miles or 1,200 miles from your family, you think you've given up something. You've given up nothing. And I have to sit back and realize it's not about me. It's not about me. It's about the urgency of seeing people come to him. Amen. Father, I thank you this morning that you are so faithful. I thank you this morning, God, that in the midst of even the greatest storm, you're able to walk in and speak calmness. Father, your word tells us that wars and famines and earthquakes and all these things must happen. You said not to be frightened. And God, I know some of us, when we think about all this, we're frightened. We're so overwhelmed. And Father, I pray for those right now that fit that category this morning. And I ask that you speak calmness and strength to them. God, that they would be able to fix their eyes so much on Jesus this morning that they would realize that their homecoming is near and that they have nothing to be frightened of, because your word said to not fear the one that can destroy the body, but to fear the one that can destroy the body and the soul. So, Father, even though we may face troubles and even though we may face a hard time, and Lord, our brothers and sisters all around this world, and what they give up for you to reach their cities and their villages and their people, Father, is nothing in comparison to us. Nothing. Father, I ask that you put such an urgency inside of us that, Lord, we don't just recognize the signs, that we don't just recognize that you're coming. But God, that urgency be so deep inside of us that when we see someone on the street, we see someone in a supermarket, that we see someone no matter where we're at and we believe that they're lost or they don't know you, God, that there be an urgency rise up inside of us and that we've got to tell them our story. We've got to tell them that there's hope. and share with them and let them know, hey, sister, hey, brother, this is what I've walked through. But let me tell you how God brought me out. Father, I pray for that one this morning that's not a Christian. Maybe they've turned their back on you for whatever reason. And God, I'm believing this morning that you spoke to hearts clearly. And Lord, the first thing in order that they need to do is they need to get right with you. They need to have a relationship with you. God's the first place they need to start. Spirit, I thank you for your conviction, God. Because it's through your conviction we're able to sense your presence and know that you're drawing us and you're leading us to a place of repentance. And Father, even like I said in Sunday school this morning, Lord, you want us to be led to repentance. You're not here to condemn us. You're here to embrace us. So, Father, I just ask that sweet embrace right now would just embrace us. Embrace us, Lord, in your strength and in your power. If you're here this morning and you're saying, I'm not ready. I'm not ready. Maybe you thought you were, and you realize this morning, I'm not ready. If I was to die today, or Jesus was to come back through those clouds today, I don't know if I'd make it home or not. And if that's you this morning, I want to pray with you. I'm not going to call you up forward. I want to pray with you right where you're at in your seat. But if that's you this morning, you're saying, I want to be ready. I want to be ready when Christ comes back. I want you to just raise your hand. Amen. 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 Father, you see each one of these hands that is raised this morning. Your word tells us that if we would confess you as Lord and believe in our heart that you were raised on the third day, that we shall be saved. So, Father, I'm going to pray right now, and God, we're going to believe for these that have raised their hands, that today marks a new day, and today they're going to walk out of here ready to go home, ready to meet you, and they're going to know that in their heart. I feel like I need to just one more time. Is there anybody else in here? You're not ready. You're like, I want to be ready if Jesus would call me home. I want to be ready. Anybody else? Church, let's pray this prayer together with them. Father, I thank you for your love and grace. And right now, I confess you as Lord. And I believe in my heart that you were raised again on the third day. So now I know that I am saved. And I am ready to go home. Thank you for the forgiveness of my sins. For I therefore repent of all my sins, and I give you glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Well, praise God.